Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
Well, we are up and running live on this Wednesday afternoon. The sun is indeed shining out there. Bucolic Gulfstream Park on a fast and firm Wednesday afternoon. That turf course will see plenty of action, including the first of nine with the post time in about 60 minutes, give or take 1:10 Eastern, as we embark on a new five-day racing week. Jason and Acacia, so good to have you with us, everybody. Hope you're doing okay. And just like that, we're back at it here at Gulfstream.
Yeah, we certainly are. We wrapped up a very exciting weekend of racing this past week, and we turn the page now and continue on in January, inching ever closer to that Pegasus World Cup. But we do start off a new week of racing, just a nine race card today, Jason, but we'll try and make it fun as we always do.
Absolutely, and fun maybe doesn't tell the tale of what we've seen lately, or what we did see transpire between Tyler Gaffleone and Saffy Joseph Jr. Yeah, they both hooked up and had big weekends, a combined five wins, and off that, Tyler has found himself, after laying low and picking his spots throughout the month of December, usually that's kind of a month our elite riders take a step back. Tyler has gained some traction, to say the least. He is fifth entering this new week as far as the standings are concerned with 16 wins. You've got a rod on top, and he'll see action in the first race with 38.
He certainly will. On Saturday, three-win day for Tyler Gaffleone along with Saffy Joseph Jr. It was also a three-win day for Paco Lopez on Saturday, though, too. He's been riding very consistently and very solidly, and between the top four, it really is pretty close, as we see now Edrad Ortiz and Luis Saez separated by just four wins, as they've continued to put on a show for us.
Absolutely. Paco, Louis, and Arad, by the way, have calls in this upcoming first race on the turf. Things are even tighter in the trainer standings. In fact, how do you like? And a lot of racing remains. There's no question about it. It's only January 8th here. But how do you like that at this point? A three-way tie for first.
Boy, it is pretty impressive for sure. And it seemed like the Navarro barn started off a little bit slow and has certainly picked up a lot of speed. Whereas you have to imagine between Saturday and Sunday with five wins, including three stakes for Saffy Joseph Jr., just been really a banner 2019 into 2020 for that barn.
Absolutely. We also sent our condolences to the connections of XYZ, including trainer Jorge Navarro, with that horse passing away this morning up at Palm Meadows. Kind of a tough situation, but a wonderful racehorse.
Yeah, he really was just as tough as they come, and reportedly suffered a heart attack after a routine gallop. So I know all of us here in South Florida that had the privilege of watching him definitely feeling that and feeling for the connections.
It was a privilege for sure. Now, as we switch gears, it might be a little tough, but we'll do just that with the nine race Wednesday coming down the pipeline. We up the ante here as far as a weekday jackpot Rainbow Six pool is concerned. How do you like that? $2 million, the guarantee, with Luis Saez and a thread of blue winning here on the turf last winter for trainer Kieran McLaughlin. $2 million bucks, the guarantee. And just to note, a little bit of a program change. It starts in race number four for the first time. I keep the rundowns on my computer. November 24th was last time we had a nine race card, and of course that was Crosstown in Miami Gardens. So this will be a fourth race starting point and launching pad for that $2 million jackpot Rainbow Six. Of course, the early pick five starts in the first at about 1:10 Eastern, and not a bad little turf maiden claim to start. You got a couple of live New York shippers knocking heads with Arad and trainer Joe Orsino, and a couple of Nickies who looks pretty dangerous. And I see you've got the two nine shippers along with Joe's horse, who has some speed.
Absolutely. You've got a couple of Nickies taking a drop in class for Orsino and Irad Ortiz, and then Days of Spring coming in for Pletcher Rapoli team and Looking Fine as Wine, first time Dom Scatino, who's had with a limited number of runners. I mean, they've really been running down here in South Florida. He's gotten lucky with a couple of off the turf races, but Javier Castellano aboard this one. I'm just going to stand alone with Same Kind of Crazy in race number two. Distinctive Lady, I thought, looked interesting, but to keep it affordable, affordable, and I wanted to spread in the fourth. That was my choice in singling there. And speaking of that fourth race, a high price maiden claiming, maiden 75, that I'm really looking forward to. I think a lot of interesting storylines and potentially some. It is theoretically a drop down, but this is a tough race for a $75,000, so $24 play for me.
Yeah, I like that fourth a lot. Yep. That's the starting point, the Rainbow Six. You'll see a troubled trip last out as well from Hey Kitten in just a few moments. Now, no last out real tough trips per se for this field, although you do have horses like the 8 Days of Spring and the 9 Looking Fine as Wine, who just to me seem pretty well meant as they ship south for the winter and drop slightly on the claiming scale. And for a horse like the 8 Days of Spring, who I still think mile and a 16th might be stretching it just a touch. I'm hoping maybe firmer ground down here in Florida this time of year may help her along on the turf course this afternoon. And clearly, we like the cold super to start.
We certainly do. And, you know, they kind of handled her with a bit of care towards the start of her career, though she wasn't getting the job done sprinting. Remember in Saratoga, she ran behind her very impressive stablemate, Sweet Melania, and they finally dropped down. And I do think that that mile race at Belmont is probably her best one to date. But this just might be the right spot for her. And she has, running for a tag recently, shown some more tactical speed. And I do like that Luis Saez has experience with her as well. Perhaps blinkers back on. They tried the blinkers once on the dirt. So kind of a first-time blinker turf move for Looking Fine as Wine. But seeing Javier Castellano take the call, who did ride this filly before with Carlos Martin up in New York. And again, just thinking this looks like a good spot for her.
And I think the four couple of Nickies is not out of this by any stretch. And I don't think when the race rolls around in a little less than an hour, she'll be far shorter than that current 9-2 and might be right on the heels of the 8 Days of Spring, because you've got a rod. And I'll tell you, that turf race, that maiden 50 run right before Halloween at GPW, I think that stacks up for this level. That stacks up perfectly. In fact, she might have the best looking dirt field, or I should say turf field, recently as she gets back on the grass.
And she was a big price and finished third that day. And even now getting her tag sliced in half, picking up by Rad Ortiz, and when putting that pick five together, I just did not want to leave her off, because she looked like she might be able to run a big one.
As we move on to the second race, in fact, you've got a single in this one, Acacia, the number two, Same Kind of Crazy, who helps for a, or hopes that is, for a fast pace, and a fast pace will indeed help her out. I looked at it, however, from the other side of the spectrum, thinking and hoping anyway that the number three, Sue's, who was scratched out of a race here Sunday for trainer Scott Becker, might just be a little faster, we'll see, than the four, Rattlesnake Rose, and could get away with her with Paco riding, because her form out in the Midwest, mainly Hawthorne of late and even Fairmont, her races have been okay, and I like that big speed in Paco.
Yeah, she does certainly have a lot of the speed, and we'll see how those races do stack up coming here to South Florida. I actually disagree with Same Kind of Crazy. I think that she can be pretty tactical in her main track races. Lately on the turf, she's been coming from so far off of it. She also had to run against Thinking Cowtown in the Claiming Crown Distaff Dash last time out, so they're kind of, it seems like to me, going back to the drawing board. And we both know owner Mike Dove, our part owner in here, he likes to beat in the winner's circle. And looking at some of those main track races back in it was in 2018, but with Rudy Rodriguez, she was much more forward than she has been lately. So I'm hoping in a compact field, that's kind of what you need to have.
Yeah, no doubt. The compact field might help her in terms of just laying up close, as you've got a rod looking for a potential early double sweep. Still 9-2 on the board with a couple of Nickies in that first race. Third, meanwhile, I'm right back to Paco as we stay on the dirt. We've got an older filly mare, three lifetime, $8,000 to $7,000 claimer. And I'm a little worried that your horse, She's One Mad Mama, and maybe to an extent the six Gossip Isle, might show enough speed where they take the starch out of the three, how sweep it is. But I do think the argument remains with her stretching out slightly to six off a 5.5 furlong race and a non-good effort up in the middle of August at Monmouth Park. I'm hoping she plays out as the dominant speed, and I'm thinking that's how she prefers to run when she's on the point. And I'll tell you, dropping in for eight and getting Paco, I think she's going to have both those things at her helm today.
And how good has Jane Sibeli's barn been lately, too? Really been in a good groove, and with Paco Lopez on a lot of those well-meant runners for sure. So certainly a trend that's worth following. I tried to get a little cute with a little bit of a price, and She's One Mad Mama, thinking that her last couple of races since they put the blinkers on seem to be moving in the right direction. She had a good main track at Tampa going 6.5 last time. I like the turn back to six for her in here today, and hoping that she can get get a chance to kind of save some ground and get in a good spot early in the race from the inside post.
Now, that inside post with her, you've got right on right next door. In fact, she's a kind of a atypical maybe trainer change to Kelly Breen.
Yeah.
You don't see Kelly run all that many lower-level claimers, certainly as new acquisitions, but that is certainly the case here with this mare, who's just, as a whole, her form maybe won't knock your socks off, but boy, does feel like she's kept a pretty high level of competition.
Yeah, she certainly has. I mean, the race is through, and she hasn't raced since February, but what she was facing in last year's championship meet were some really, really tough horses, so certainly take a look at that. She's a five-year-old mare by Overdriven, who hasn't seen the winner's circle in a while, but she's been consistent, so we'll see if she fires today.
All right, as we fire right into that opening break here on this Wednesday edition of Gulfstream Today, coming up after this. Crazy to think we're just 17 days out from the fourth running of the Pegasus World Cup here at Gulfstream Park, presented by Run Happy. And with the race less than 3 weeks away, I was thinking about the previous three dirt editions of the Pegasus occasion, thinking about how lucky we were to see Arrogate, then Gunrunner, then City of Light. Thought it would be fun to kind of have this fictional race up for grabs on Twitter. And to my surprise, Arrogate is a clear winner. I thought he and Gunrunner might be a little closer. My wife and I discussed this. She liked Gunrunner, but Arrogate's my top pick if these three were to knock heads in a very fictional race.
You know what, and it's a great question, too. Arrogate at his peak was really sensational, and yes, he beat Gunrunner earlier on, but then Gunrunner really seemed to blossom later, so it would be really interesting to see at both of their peaks what would happen and what a race that would be, but we have been fortunate. Breeders' Cup Classic winner Arrogate, Breeders' Cup Classic and Horse of the Year Gunrunner, Dirt Breeders' Cup Dirt Mile winner City of Light, and potential Horse of the Year in Bricks and Mortar in the Turf as well. We've had some real superstars in the starting gate.
And that poll up for the next few hours if you want to hop on to Twitter and join the conversation and join the fun. And Bob Baffert, by the way, won that inaugural Pegasus with Arrogate. He is back in the mix, potentially, certainly on the list of official invitees for the body of the race. He's got McKinsey. And we'll see ultimately what he does, but it sounds like Roadster is indeed the one that is unequivocally coming to South Florida for the fourth running of the Pegasus.
And it seemed like that kind of looked like a little bit of a game plan for Roadster all along. Been a horse that's been right there in a lot of the big dances for sure, but you certainly once again got quite a list in here. These are the invitees, so we'll see over the next few days how the race does start to shape up, and then you see the reserve invitees as well in order of preference. So no, I think no matter what happens, we're going to have a very interesting race in the starting game.
Going to be great. Going to be great. Going to be a big field. And maybe for the first time, depending upon, I know you've got Omaha Beach, but you may not have a favorite who's as short as the three prior Pegasus winners, where at times they were billed as a one-horse or two-horse race. Might be a little deeper this go-round for the wagering side of things. Anyway, we go forward, and a hearty welcome back to this live Wednesday edition of Gulfstream Today from our Clubhouse Studios, high above the finish line. Acacia and Jason, hope you're doing all right, and we appreciate your company. Now, starting a new five-day racing week here at GP as we inch closer to the Pegasus on January 25th, presented by Run Happy. That reminds me, we've got a little Stronach 5, another weekend on tap, and a bi-coastal sequence, for sure, the family is without a doubt involved.
Absolutely. We got everybody in the mix. It starts at Laurel Park in Maryland. We head out west to Santa Anita Park, picking up the opener there. Come back here to South Florida for race 9 at Gulfstream. Back to California and hit Golden Gates. And then come back and wrap up here at Gulfstream Park in race 10. And as always, that 12% takeout makes for some really nice payoffs.
And Blewett will be making his highly anticipated.
We know who Jason Single is.
Yes, he'll be in the ninth race. I would assume. I haven't seen the morning line yet. You would think he's probably going to go favorite in there. So fingers crossed, and kind of neat that he also is in one of the Gulfstream Park Stronach 5 races late here on Friday afternoon, January 10th. Speaking, it won't be a Blewett in the hot seat, but it'll be a Nicoletti for Beat the Expert.
Yes,
and
be.
You can sign on to GulfstreamPark.com, hop on, and play for free.
Absolutely. It is for free. You have the chance to win one of those great polo shirts, or cool polo shirts, as Ron likes to say, if you pick more winners. That is every Friday, and Jason and I are just glad it's not one of us.
Yep, I still have a week and change reprieve from being back in Beat the Expert. It's always a good time.
It is.
And hope you'll play. And you, again, 10 race card. You can sign up now over at GulfstreamPark.com and put those entries in. You can also get involved in today's $2 million jackpot Rainbow Six. It'll start in the fourth race for the first time this winter season here at Gulfstream Park. And how are you attacking this thing?
All right. Well, it starts in the fourth, which, as Jason mentioned, makes it a little bit more interesting and tricky, and it does start with that Main in 75 race that I had mentioned earlier. So wanting to have a little bit of coverage in this particular race, where I like a couple of different horses, and in race number 6 as well, which I think is very interesting, and I'm really curious to see how the wagering plays out in the 6th race, because I think it's kind of wide open and a lot of different options of how to go. So using two horses in the rest of the sequence so that I could spread in those two for $51.20 with that $2 million guaranteed jackpot.
Now you're four deep here, not to cut you off, I apologize, but four deep to start. Good-looking cast of three-year-old fillies in this high-priced $75,000 to $65,000 maiden claimer. It is a race, although we picked against the 6 Hey Kitten. I think first and foremost, she's the one. If you were to line them up, she's got to be talked about first because she's dropping down slightly in class, and she's coming out of a trip. Was it a race-ending type trouble trip situation at the quarter pole? Probably not, but she's still found herself in a dicey spot there. I mean, really tight between horses as the number one, and a lot went right for this horse where she was inside until this portion of the far turn, and Ricardo Santana Jr. will try to angle her out between, and you could see her getting bounced around. It was really, really tight in that spot, and she's outfooted off the far turn, but she's run well enough, I think, looking at her four races to date, where she's just simply the filly to beat in this one.
I think she is, too. Now, she had come off of a little bit of a layoff there. She finished 6th, but she was beaten under 4 lengths, and I thought that the horse that won, obviously, with 9-5, Runway Dreamer, I know that we agreed that was the horse to beat on that day, for sure. Yitzhak Rad Ortiz up today, and I had noticed she was a bit of a distracted filly in the paddock last time out, too, so I'm curious to see how she is now 2nd off the bench, and she wasn't sharpest out of the gate last time too, so maybe now after that bit of a freshening, got some of the cobwebs off, we'll see a little bit of a sharper effort. But I, and clearly like you, thought Unexplainable on a little bit of the drop in class for Ralph Nix, whose young horses in these maiden special weights have really just been running solidly. I actually thought that she ran sneakily okay in that first race, which has proved to be very productive, obviously, with 3 next out winners, and she's my type winning the Ginger Brew. But I thought that this filly had every reason to take a step forward.
I'm with you. And watching, and this was in a span of last week's 5-day racing cards here at Gulfstream Park. From Wednesday through Sunday, we saw a combined 3 winners from that She's My Type race, including, as you correctly stated, She's My Type. It looks like a star turf filly in the making for Christophe Camond. But Osaka Girl won, and Hurricane Breeze scored out of that race as well for
nice
trainer
horses,
Brendan
yeah.
Walsh. And she was Unexplainable right in the thick of things down inside until 16 poles. She started to tire a bit. Mm-hmm. She's supposed to move forward off a debut at nearly 50-1 odds this afternoon. I felt the Distorted Humor filly first, or Wasia for Brendan Walsh might run. It looks like she's got turf pedigree 4 days. In fact, out of this mare, 7 have tried the turf. five of them have actually won on the grass. I'm sure you saw that.
I saw that. Pretty impressive. And a couple of stakes winners in there as well. I thought of another first-time starter, the seven special liaison for Dave Fox, could be pretty interesting as well. This one's half to Casa Creed, who's a really nice turf horse for Bill Mott, a grade two winner, in fact, as well, by liaison. So it should be interesting. But Dave Fox with Louis Saez with first-time starters is 2-for-5 winning and 3-for-5 in the money. So small number, but when you see him reach out for Louis Saez, I thought that was a little bit interesting.
Yeah, he's not wasting Louis' time and Rich DePasse's. That's for sure. All right, anyway, fifth race, kind of a Wednesday early bird for this time of the year anyway, late pick five as we kick things off with a $36 play. I've got coverage. You went four deep, right?
I went four deep in the sixth as well.
Yeah, yeah. I'm four deep there as well. You've got that key rematch, which we'll discuss between Shanghai Bonnie and Little Nicole, and then a couple of drop-downs who I think will run pretty well. My single comes obviously down the line in the eighth race. It looks like Codrington, who lost a tough one, and boy, she was beaten by a very sharp Bella Porte last time out, who got just a heads-up ride from Edgar Zayas, one of those, like, put your bandit mask on rides and ride off into the sunset.
He stole
that race on the front end, and she really ran well, and I think even though she moves from Maker to a new barn, you're dealing with Elizabeth Dobles, whose horses have been running exceptionally well. Codrington as the favorite, my single in race number eight. I am 5-6-7 towards the outside in this upcoming fifth race, a 62-50 claimer. Obviously, we don't know who's going to win, or at least I don't know who's going to win, but I just, when I looked at the program, either I'm wrong or the morning line is a little out of whack in this race. And I say that because I just felt to, when I looked at the race, that the six, Smoke and Gloat, was the horse to beat and going to be favored. Yeah. And I don't know if you're going to get the 6-1, which is the case in the program, but I felt as though I'm mentioning all this because I feel in any sort of like logical discussion, he has to be the starting point considering he's in off a big drop with some good-looking Chicago races of late, and he gets Louis.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I used him second. I picked Octobonte with Jane Sibelli, but for absolutely no reason would I discredit Smoke and Gloat and what he's done so far. Mm-hmm. He's going to be the main controlling pace. I thought the British Bred and Octobonte for Jane Sibelli and Paco Lopez, you like them a little bit earlier in the card.
Sure.
I'll try to get them home here. But seeing Paco take the call, won an open company last time out, and yes, it was a sealed track that day. Just thought that this one sticking on the main track might sit just off of Smoke and Gloat. But I thought the race really did revolve around whether Smoke and Gloat just runs them off their feet.
Yeah, could be the case. We'll see. Animal Trick maybe has some speed. And I'm curious if they bet the Four Diamond Majesty.
I saw
Jay had that horse pretty short. He looks like a much better turf horse to my eyes. And he's also got to go 7 furlongs on the dirt. But he is obviously taking a very precipitous drop down to 6250.
It's a drop in class. I used him fourth because I actually wasn't really sure what to do with him myself. But I actually thought Doc Kane could be a little bit interesting first off the claim for a sharp claiming barn and having a little bit of a freshening.
Yeah, it's funny. Dr. Harlan and Doc Kane are down inside post one and two. So the doctor's in this case. They are absolutely in that fifth race as we turn the page and we come up on a race that Acacia and I both saw fit to use four in our respective rainbow and late pick five tickets. And for good reason, I think, in this 5 furlong older filly mare, two lifetime, $16,000 to $14,000 claimer. Why don't we look at the very familiar Shanghai Bonnie and Little Nicole race first? And they both ran well with very different trips, where Shanghai Bonnie in the hot pink silks of Flying Pea Stables chased outside and vied outside behind the winner, coincidentally, in Charlie Anna. And then Arad Ortiz just sat inside and he'll angle out between horses. A good effort here off the pace for the four Little Nicole. They both ran fine in this spot. I think as time has gone on, however, certainly for no other reason, looking at this field from inside to out, Acacia, to me, this is a way, way, way tougher field as far as the depth chart goes today as opposed to this race.
I totally agree with you. And I thought, yes, it was a big performance from both of them. Little Nicole actually was closing really nicely that day off of a layoff. Second off the bench, can she repeat or improve off of that kind of performance? Shanghai Bonnie's been consistent as well when running on the turf and running at the right level. And both you and I going in different directions. And I'll admit, I really liked Pins and Needles at first. That was my top pick who did scratch out of this race. So I scratched into Moon Eyes, who this was a filly I just kept going back to. I had initially used her second. I didn't love the idea of keeping her on top, but just not having a a real preference for anybody else on top. Her turf races have been, again, significantly tougher. She's taking a drop. Luis Saez up for Gustavo Delgado, who's had a sneaky, very good meet here for sure.
He definitely has as a whole. Her races have been poor, but new face here dropping down, as is the case with the one Avocado Toast on the rail, and even the seven Shanghai Mistress, who I think in the end might be best when she's on the lead.
Yes, she is.
I am hoping. It does look like this pace, or at least that first flight, could get a little crowded and might have a few different bodies mixing it up. I'm hoping she might just be the speed of the speed, but a good little race there on
it
the
is.
Turf.
A yeah, very interesting sure. race for sure.
Definitely. Now, the seventh race, there were very few scratches and changes on the card today, and you'll have Pete coming up in a couple minutes. Maybe the biggest one, however, happened to fall in race number seven in Cerro Una Volta. And I think with that horse out, the pace here is certainly altered to an extent, and maybe that makes life for my top pick, the number three, very amusing with mm-hmm. his speed, a little bit easier. I also like that race. I just like that field he's coming out of, won by Silent Tiger. I think for the level, the race he's coming out of was pretty salty.
And he was actually favored in that race, and he was fourth that day, and he's been solid. I will say this barn, who had a really breakout 2019, I'd say, has been very quiet as far as the win column for the championship meet, but has had a couple of solid runners and does well claiming horses and spotting them properly. So I certainly respect Very Amusing. I liked Lawyer Drill to the outside, who you thought was mm-hmm. a logical player as well. Was off the turf last time, on the turf two starts back. The main track race prior to that was very impressive, and I think this is where he prefers to be.
Yeah, his dirt races have been fine of late, and he's arguably, I think, the horse to beat off that form. Speaking of horse to beats, as we wrap things up and take our final two-turn lap around the Gulfstream Park turf course today, we'll fall in race number eight. Got some older fillies and mares in this 35 starter race. We had touched upon Codrington. I singled her and think ultimately this is a pretty good spot to wheel back with less than 2 weeks between starts. And here is that last start a couple of days after Christmas here, where she just ran great.
Yes,
she got no pace whatsoever. That gray mare on the lead, Bella Porte, this was like a classic Edgard's eyes. He's so good on speed, Edgard, and just lulled them to sleep, as they say. And I mean, through no fault of her own, Codrington probably ran the better race with what she was able to do and the ground she made up. And I don't think she has to improve. I just think her body of work, we get the good Codrington, and that's been a story without winning, mind you. She's got a lot of seconds, but her form in the end, I think, is a little bit better than the others in this race.
I totally agree with you, and hopefully there actually should be a little bit of pace for her to run at in here. We'll see. I think Tipple stretching out on the outside with Jaramillo up might show some speed. Desire might show a little bit of speed. Take Charge Tina, hopefully. So that should set up things better for Codrington, who just kept trying and trying last time out.
Yep, for sure. Now, race number nine. We'll wrap things up here. Dirt finale on this rare nine race Wednesday. An older filly mare, 8 to 7,000 claimer, led by, we talked about Codrington maybe having a bit better recent form than the others. I think the filly to beat off three very solid races on the dirt. Mm. That moniker belongs to the number three, Vicky Apple. Here she is last time out here, a couple of weeks into the winter season here on December 13th, doing her thing as a speed horse. She may not get the lead today over the 10 Infinity Sky, and she's also, here's the caveat with her, good form, but she's up in class. These are better horses than what she trounced last time.
I agree. She's going to have her running shoes on in here today, and you mentioned Infinity Sky. Infinity Sky is the one that beat her two starts back and making her three quarters of a length away from an unbeaten three-race streak in here. So she does have to step up a bit after getting the non-winners of three condition last time out, but she's been very good. I went with Untrue. A very slight drop in class for her. She's been consistent. I know she's kind of been knocking on the door, but I thought that she had the consistency to maybe get the job done today.
And she'll come out of the same race. In fact, I am all December 6th, race number three on that card with Untrue second, behind the number four, Baby Monster, who just failed the fire running in a slightly better field, and she's down in class and had obviously run okay for trainer Joe Orsino in those two races earlier in the fall over at Gulfstream Park West. As we take a little time out, we'll have Ronnie, good old Ron Nicoletti, joining us downstairs from our paddock set studio, and we'll turn the mic over to track announcer Pete Aiello with those scratches and changes.